describe the session's agenda, right? So before that, I'll share a few informations about myself. So yesterday also I shared, like, I have a overall 5 years of experience in IT industry, basically backend developer working in R&D sectors. And also I have a working experience in teaching. I worked in some technical institute as an instructor and trainer, almost 5 to 6 years I worked. So this is all about, and my current company is Pramati Technologies. And before that I was associated with Verizon India. So this is all about me. And training is my, teaching, giving training. So it's my passions, you can say. So let's start our sessions. So today's agenda is related to Java 8. Okay. So Java 7 has been released 2012, and then Java 8 came 2014 March, right? So Java 7, it was has lots of features, like including that, switch expressions they have modified, and they have multi exceptions. Pipeline, with the pipeline you can add the multiple exceptions. Those are the basic features of Java 7. Now Java 8, what are the major features? So number one major features is functional interface along with Lambda expressions, and second one is your Streams API. So those are the major features related to Java 8. So along with that, they have modified the interface definitions. They have introduced method reference, and also what they did. So they have introduced new time API, and they changed their JVM architecture. Earlier it was called permanent generations. They removed it and they introduced metaspace, and they introduced some annotations, and they have introduced few more classes for null pointer exceptions. Nothing but a NPE. Null pointer exceptions. So those are the most challenges while any developer working any Java project. So null pointer exceptions is, someone said, like, it's a $1 million of mistake for a developer. So they have introduced few classes. So with that help of those classes, we can actually avoid that null pointer exceptions. So those are the major changes of Java 8. And now let's move our sessions. So in my yesterday's sessions, I talk about, like, what are the changes they have introduced in interfaces, right? So first of all, I have shown one example related to interfaces. Okay. So number one changes is related to interface is they have introduced static method and default method, right? So what is that static method and default method? So earlier in Java 7 or before that Java 8, all the versions, so the definitions of interface was it should be 100% abstract, right? And abstract class definitions was it should be 0 to 100%. So if any interviewer asks this question, so normally people will give this answer, right? But Java 8 completely changed that definitions. We know whatever the method we just provide in that interface before Java 8, it was nothing but a abstract, right? So whenever we need to implement any interface, so if our class is not abstract, so we have to provide that implementations, right? So so the definitions has been changed. So they have introduced default and static methods. So what is the purpose of default and static methods? So why they did? If any interviewer asks the questions, that answer should be one line for backward compatibility. So what is that backward compatibility? Okay, let me give you one broad scenarios. Okay. Suppose you are working in some companies and you are working for that project last 10 years, okay, and that project has been developed Java 7. Now client is asking, like, we need to upgrade our Java from 7 to 8. In production environment, they wants to upgrade JDK 8. So if you upgrade and JDK 8, so your code should not be work in that JDK 8. Why? The main difference is yesterday I was also talking about collections interface, right? So collection, this interface, if they will modify anything, suppose they want to add one new abstract method for providing new facility in that interface. Okay. So in your project, you have implemented that collections interface. So that is means when your program will run in that productions environment on JDK 8 platform, so that time it will give error compile time, because you didn't implemented that newly added abstract method inside that interface, right? So that's what I mean, your code will be fail. So your code will not run. So what they came up these solutions? They came up these solutions. Okay, we'll introduce a static and default method. So if, I mean, earlier project, they use that interface and we are introducing new facility corresponding interface, they don't need to change that code. They don't need to implement those abstract method. So that's what I mean, they have given default and static method. If you see, I mean, if you go to these sections I'm showing you, if you go to your C drives and then your programs, and from Java, you just go to the JDK part. If you are installed JDK 8, so there is a SRC folder. You just take this SRC folder and then extract it. So I have already done it. I am showing you. Okay. So Java SRC. So if you extract this one, so you will find that collections interface, right? So already I have opened in Eclipse. So that's what I am showing in Eclipse. So you can see lots of default method they have introduced. Okay. So fine. Let's see, find out. Okay. So you can see that they have introduced since Java 1.8. So default method is remove. So likewise, they have introduced lots of default and static method in different interface. So that is means, so it's supporting that backward. I mean, if your project is earlier versions and if you are trying to upgrade your Java from 7 to 8, so you don't need to change anything in the code level. So this is called actually backward compatibility. So one is static method, another is default method, right? So static method and default method, there is a two difference. Okay. So in default method, you can override, but a static method you can't override. So this is the small difference inside that interface. And while introduce that default method, there is a problem in diamond problem. Like we have seen for multiple inheritance, there was a diamond problem. Similarly, there is a another diamond problem. So let's see. I have a two interface hash color. You can see I have default method print spec and also transform. This is another interface. I have a default method print spec. So this is actually abstract method transform. So you can see my two interface. Okay. My two interface which have same method, default method. Now, as per interface, I mean, as per inheritance definitions, one class can implement n numbers of interface simultaneously, right? But one class can extend only another class at a time, right? That is the definitions. So let me draw one picture. Okay. So I am saying like this one. Okay. So this is my one class. Okay. This is my A, B, and C. So C class actually implements A and B to interface. A interface also having same default method, B interface also having same default method. So while it's using one default method of the interface, so in runtime, so JVM will unable to understand, right? So which method it should call, from this interface or this interface? This is basically diamond problem. Same thing is happening for class. So that's what I mean, Java restricted, like if you try to implement extend two class at a time, so it will give you that compile time error, right? So this is diamond problem. So if you take a one example, you can see this is a one basket and this is another basket. This basket also have yellow color ball and this basket also have yellow color ball. Okay, and now you have put in C basket. So now C basket, it has two yellow color ball. Now one person is there. We are asking these persons, okay, find out the yellow color ball which has been taken from basket A. How that person will able to identify? He cannot identify, right? Unless until you mark it something special on that ball, that persons cannot identify, okay, this yellow color ball is came out from this A basket and this yellow color ball is came out from B basket. So that is actually diamond problem. So what they did, you can think, like in yellow ball they have marked it A and in B yellow ball they have marked it B. Then that person can easily identify, okay, this yellow color ball came from A basket and these yellow color balls came from B basket. Although that color is same, but we have identified uniquely A and B. Similarly, JVM, in order to solve this default diamond problem in interface, they have given some solutions so that JVM can understand, okay, this is came from this A interface and this is came from B interface. This A marking and B marking is nothing but we are doing with the help of super keyword. Okay, let's see the example. So this is diamond problem, right? So this is my class implement hash color and transform. So you can see print spec, what I did. I just mentioned, you just use hash color dot super dot print spec. So super keyword required. Super means you are actually calling this default method from that hash color actual interface. Here, if you make it transform, then you will find out that transform method will run. So let me run this code. Just wait, already I have run it. So my idea is little bit slow. Okay, where is that output? You can see hash color specifications. Now go to hash color. You can see inside hash color interface default method hash color specifications. Now if you change, this is from transform. Little bit slow my ID. Okay, so let's take this one. And where is that transform? Okay, so now save it and now run it. You'll see transform specifications default method. So just runtime, I mean, you are actually marking, okay, JVM. So this is my, you will use this one. So this how we can solve this diamond problem. Correct. So we have seen this diamond problem in Java 8. Now we'll see in static method. Who's that? So a static method, what is happening? So a static method, you don't need to worry about that diamond problem because static method, you cannot override it. Like, so it's a similar like how you are actually doing in case of any normal class. So while you are actually trying to communicate with any normal class static method. So just class dot this method name. So automatically you will find out this, you will get the result. But what is the main use of a static method? So number one is uses, like you can create utility method of the static method with the help of a static method. And second thing is, for security reason, it's helpful because you cannot override the static method. So it's a similar implementations. You just what you will do, so you will have a simple interface. You can have a n numbers of abstract method, don't worry. Just you just have only one static method or n numbers of a static method. There is a no hard and fast rules like it should be one or it should be zero. As per your requirement, you can put n numbers of a static method. So how you will access? You will access like this way. So normally you'll have you seen, like I have done this and I have used this fly. So just you just trying to create this object and you just call the fly. You don't need to provide any things. So this is the static method. And let me tell you one thing, like there is a collections class, right? So collections class is the utility class providing the support for that collections API. So there is a lots of utility method like sorting method and synchronize to convert. So those methods is there and you can perform these operations because list is not a what is called sorted data. So in order to sort list, you can use that collections dot sort as list. So there is a, you can find lots of static methods there, but they have introduced because of provide that support to collections API. So this is a utility class. So right now Java can do, they can obsolete this collections class and they can put all the static method inside that interface. There is a no need, right? Because they have introduced this one. So this is related to interface. And now I'll talk about that functional interface. So before interface, I want to share few informations. So now what is the definitions of abstract and interface? So it's a common questions to any, if you are trying to attend any interview, so that time you will face these questions. So now you can say both interface and abstract, those are 0 to 100% abstract. So it's providing the abstractions or data hiding, but it's a not 100%. But the difference still there, abstract class can have a constructor, a state and behavior. And second things, in abstract class, you can create any method. I mean, any method you can, and you can create any non abstract method, but it should not be static and default. But in interface, apart from this static and default, you cannot create any normal non abstract method. Okay. And third number, in interface, by default, all the variables should be public, static, final. If you declare any variable int, okay, it should be by default public, static and final. So what is happening, I am sharing one broad level knowledge. So I have seen in few project, okay, so when right now whenever you need to declare any constant, so you create any class and inside that class always you will write these things, public, static, final, your variable time, let's say string, and s1 equals to take Java. So like you use this one, but instead of these things, I have seen so many, I mean companies, I mean like I have seen Infosys 2 to 3 project, I mean they have used this one with the help of interface. What they did now, they did only these things. And if you call the interface, you will get the same things because it's a by default public static final. So this is the third difference. Okay. And fourth difference is like, so I mean, you can make anything public, private, protected inside that abstract class, but by default, it should be public in that interface. So those four, five differences is still there. So everyone is saying like interface and abstract class is same now. It's not the fact. Still, there is a difference. So those are the difference as I explained you. And now we'll see about the functional interface. So what is functional interface? So functional interface, just remember one definition. It can contain only one abstract method. And it can and cannot be contain static and default method. I mean, if one interface contain only one abstract method, it should be treated as a functional interface. It can be contain more than it can contain n numbers of static and default method, doesn't matter, but it should contain only one abstract method, that is functional interface. So we just anode this functional interface at the rate of functional interface. If you check runnable, this interface is a functional interface, because runnable, this interface contained only one method run, while we are actually creating the thread. So that time we use that runnable interface, right? So you can see they have marked functional interface. So now the questions is, interview might be asked the questions. Is that required to add this @ functional interface? No, it's not a mandatory. Then why they use? Is use like one developer might be wants to create any interface as a functional interface, and another developer is working in the same project, and wrongly he has put another abstract method inside that interface. So that is means there is a that interface is now it's not a functional interface because it's contain two abstract method. So to check that, to give the type safety and to check at the compile time error, so that's what you can use that functional interface annotations. Means if you annot any interface, so that is means you are not allowed to add more than one abstract method. Got it? So that is the point. Okay. And okay. So this is the definitions of functional interface. And let me give you the few functional interface they have introduced. Okay. So first of all, I want to show you that Java package. So if you go to Java package, I mean, after extract that SRC folder, you just go to util. So you will find out there is a, under util package, there is a introduced new package called function. So there you can see lots of functional interface. And if you check now, all the interface contain only one abstract method. It can contain multiple static and default method, doesn't matter, but contain only one abstract method. Now, why this one abstract method? Yes, because provide the support in order to achieve and in order to do the functional programming and in order to use that lambda expressions, that's what this functional interface concept came. And that's what they have introduced that definition, it should contain only one abstract method. Yes, because of lambda expressions. We'll see later, but before that, let me quickly describe you few important functional interface. So one is function. So function is the interface, it will take it one type of argument and it will return type is different. Okay, so you are giving X, it is returning Y. Supplier means always it will supply. Okay, so that is means it will not take anything, so it will always return you some things. Okay, predicate is nothing but a testing. So it has an abstract method called test. So if you give some inputs to that predicate test method, so it will give you the result whether true or false. I mean boolean value, consumer. It will always consume. So that is means it's saying, okay, give me, I'll consume. So it has always accept this abstract method. It's a taking one argument, let's say x or t type, and it's nothing returning. So there is a lots of by consumer is there. It's a taking two types. Then other thing is there, like a long supplier. So it will supply long type of data. Return type should be long. Okay, so long predicate. So there is a, I mean, all those thing is there. But main things you need to understand that four interface: function, predicate, supplier, and consumer. So based on that, you can see all the similar. It's a long functions, long predicate, long to double functions, long to in functions. So those are all that you can say it's a sub functional interface. So now let me show you one function, right? So I said it has only this method apply. So it's a taking type T and returning R. And you can see here, find out lots of default method is there. Okay, but doesn't matter. Default and static method, it only contain one abstract method. So that's what it is annotated at the rate functional. Okay, so this is functional interface. You can similarly go through that predicate or some others. Okay, so if you go to these things, so you will find out, okay, this is return type is boolean and it has that test method. So this is actually basically functional interface. So you just try to find out, okay, I mean, we'll discuss that some others concept, we have to cover it. So now we'll see the lambda expressions. So as I said, what is the main task of lambda expressions? Main task of the lambda expressions is like to instantiate any functional interface. To instantiate any functional interface, main task of the lambda expressions. And we can achieve our program in a functional way. You know, Java, in Java, there is a one drawback, like whenever you need to work in particular project or there is some requirement from the client side, right? So always you have to write some method and then you have to create the object and then you have to call the method with that object reference, right? So that there is a no functional way, like in C or others programming language is providing the facility. Okay, so you need this one, you can create the function and you can use it. So that's what lambda expressions and functional interface introduce to achieve that functional programming. And in order to instantiate the functional interface, we'll use that lambda expressions. So this is the answer if anyone asks in interview. Now, what was the problem earlier happening in Java? So suppose there is a criteria. So client criteria is you will get a person details and you will find out. So I mean, who are, you have to create a logic, who are males and who are belongs to age 25 to 34, you have to provide their details. So naturally what you will do? So naturally you will try to create one interface and you will create one abstract method called test. It's a nothing but like that. And then you will provide that implementations and you will write the all the logic in that test method. And finally, you are actually calling this one. So this is one approach, right? And another approach is you can do it with the help of anonymous class. So anonymous class, what is the definitions? Anonymous class, it's I mean, you are actually creating the object with the same new keyword, but you are not creating the reference for the future purpose. For one times you are creating. Okay, so this is a anonymous class. But who will use the anonymous class? Suppose they have introduced this one. If their requirement is after few days, okay, so we have to add few others criteria, which I mean, I mean, if person is employed or unemployed, you have to check the person. So like if they will add several things, so based on that, you have to constantly change your method or everything, right? So those are the problems. So that's what actually lambda expression came. So main reason is like if you try to increase your search criteria or any further new requirements will come in your project. So each and every time you need to add new methods or new things. So in order to avoid those kind of things, okay, we are providing the functional way. So you just use it and it's a single line of code and you can achieve the same things. So that's what lambda expressions and functional interface came. So let's see the functional interface. We'll see lambda expression syntax, right? Okay. So point number one. So lambda expressions, one is called left side, another is right side. So inside and middle should be arrow mark. So arrow mark left side and arrow mark right side. So what we'll do? So just remember one point. In arrow mark left side, you will write actually your method and what are the parameters you want to pass to that method. So which method, I'll tell you, just wait, be patient. And right side, you have to write your actual logic. I was saying, so there is a test method. So test method, you are actually passing that person object. So you can see this left side is actually you are passing that object. And right side, you are actually writing, okay, you are taking, okay, that person is within this age to this age, or this person is a male or not. Okay, so those kind of logic you will always write in right side. Okay, so if, and second things you need to remember, if only one argument, you don't need to give it bracket, I mean parenthesis. Okay, and if there is a one statement in the right side, you don't need to give that curly bracket. If there is a multiple, you use that curly bracket. It's a similar like a if else statement. If there is a one statement inside that if, no need curly. If there is a multiple, need curly bracket. Similarly, if there is a more than two arguments, so that time you have to use that parenthesis and it's a comma separated. And also providing the argument, I mean mentioning the argument type, I mean variable type, I mean string or integer, it should not be needed. It should not be needed. You can avoid, it's not a mandatory. So like this is a simplified one. And also for a return type is not required if you are using one statement. So you can see. So return also obsolete and this bracket is also obsolete. Because as I said, this is a one statement. And as I said, always your right side should be written something, right? So this is not required. Okay, so now we'll see what should I do with the lambda expressions. Okay, as I said, you don't need anything. Okay, so what you need? So lambda expressions, just showing you one lambda expressions example. Okay, so there is a calculator. You can see this is the abstract method and this is a functional interface. Only one abstract method is there. Okay, and now I want to calculate some values, like I want to calculate it's a multiply by 100. So what I did, you can see I have provide the implementations right here, but with the lambda expressions, how we can do it with same things, but a, then my arrow, and then a into 100. So this left a is nothing but is my actually this method argument, this x I am passing. Okay, this is a, actually left side is taking actually these things. If you see na, so actually we are annotating like this way, we are actually marking this way. So this is actually method argument, this is nothing but a this. Okay, and this right side actually this is the argument. Actually we should write this one, it's gone. We should write this one, right? We should write this one. And if you using return, then you have to provide this arrow bracket. Okay, and there is some error, we have to give a. Okay, okay, so this is the my solution. So now simplified, I told for a single statement return is not required, also arrow mark is not required. So just simplify this one. So this is the lambda expressions. And now the question is how these lambda expressions identify, okay, so this will be assigned to this method. How? Because that is the twist point. I said functional interface content only one abstract method. It should not be contain more than one abstract method. So that is means with the lambda expressions, you are actually providing the implementations of that abstract method, which is stay in the functional interface. Got my point? So this is the actual reason. So if you put here two abstract methods, right, in calculate or something, so lambda expressions cannot be identified, cannot be instantiated. Okay, so that is why. So we don't need to mention this method name. We are actually providing the argument. If you delete this one, nothing will be happen. It's the same things, right? So this is actually lambda expressions. I think that lambda expressions concept clear. And now, just giving you one example. Whenever you are doing, we are actually creating any thread, right? Shall I create it? Let me see. I have created or not. So when you are actually creating thread, so that time you will use that runnable interface. So runnable is a functional interface. So you can do it. It's a very simple way. Like, if you give, as I said, like here, right, in calculator. So if you give, something, your thread dot thread something, it should be there. And if you use that this dot this, and if you provide this one, automatically your runnable, if you provide this one a or something, this argument, and you don't need to provide it, and if you write your logic here, automatically this will taken care or it will assign to that run method of this runnable interface. You don't need to worry about this. So this is the actually functional programming. So, and another last topic of this slide is method reference. So what is the purpose? So there is a four kind of method reference. One is reference to a static method, another is reference to a instant method, and another is a reference to a constructor, and another is a reference to an instant method of an arbitrary object. So I am saying you, giving you one example. Have you seen, I want to show you one example. So let me show you that example. What is the purpose of method reference? See, main thing is why interface came, because of lambda expressions. But just tell me, with that syntax, this syntax, are you able to understand like what is the method, what is doing? It's a very difficult, right? So lambda expressions, this expressions is it's a little bit critical, but it's easy, but it's not able to understand whole things. So in order to provide that simplicity, they have introduced that method reference. Then what is the purpose of the method reference? It's nothing but it's a simplify the lambda expressions. Okay, and it will give you that proper visibility. So let me show you the example. Sessions 2. Okay. You know, might be most of the person have you seen these things we have used. Okay. Okay. Let me write. Say dot for each. Okay. Say dot for each V. Okay. System println. Println. There is some errors. Actually, my ID is problem. So sometimes it gives unwanted result. You can see my ID already hanged. Okay, don't worry. I am showing you the example in other way. My ID already hanged. Okay. So so method reference. What I was saying. So completely this ID gone. What happened? Okay. So method reference I was showing, right? There was giving some error. Okay, so I'll check later. By the way, I am showing you some example of method reference. So if you see that I was telling you, like in order to convert from any string to integer. So what I did now, so I have taken this result and then I have converted it, right? So with the same things we can achieve it with the method reference. This is the actually syntax of method reference. Okay, so what they are doing, so method reference we are saying, so integer, so normally we do integer dot value of this from, right? So what I did here, so I did integer, so you'll use that value of this method, so automatically it will assign to this one, so you don't need to use that value form and this is the lambda expression. Just with the help of these things we can easily get these things. I can understand like your concept has not been clear related to this method reference, but don't worry, in that while I'll discuss about this stream API, so that time I'll show you how actually it's working. It's my ID, there is some problem. So but for the time being, just you can keep it in your mind, like while we are actually creating any we are actually using that lambda expressions, so that time easily we can annotate that corresponding method with that double colon operator. So we are saying like this is the operator, you don't need to use this one, you just use this one. Okay. So here we can show the example. Yes, we can show. Well, let me show you later this method difference. So this is our first sessions, and now if you go to the second sessions, so I have said about collections API improvement, right? So in order to collections API improvement, so what they have improved? So number one, how you are iterating any map in earlier. Okay, so earlier iterating any map, so we used to iterator, enumerations, list iterator, and enhanced for loop. So those three things is called as a cursor in Java. So these three, iterator, numerator, and list iterator. List iterator only for applicable for any list type of collections. Okay, it should not be apply set or others map. And enumerations and iterator is for apply for both. And enhanced for loop also used. But Java 8 is giving you that method called for each method and lambda expressions. With these things, you can easily iterate your collections, any collections data. So like I am showing you the example. I mean, before Java 8, how we used to iterate any map or anything. So this is my map, right? So I am putting some value with key string, and my value is integer. So now either I have to use that map.entry, it's a common way, or you can use that iterator, hashed iterator. So there is a lots of, I mean, key set, key values. There is a 5-6 ways is there. Okay. So with that ways, I mean, we can iterate the map. But after Java 8, so it's a very easy. What we are actually doing, you can see, for any list or any things, what just that your list or vector dot for each and lambda expressions, then system dot out dot println. Got it? So, and even I said you don't need this one. If you delete this one, it's nothing will be happen, right? So this is the things. But if you trying to iterate any map, so you just assign, you just need to iterate key and value. So key comma v, as I said, for two arguments you need to provide that bracket, and then system dot out dot println k plus v, automatically it will return. Got it. Now one, so like with this for each method, we can iterate any collections. This is the one of the major features. Okay, so just you if you write any collections, I mean, it's a set, hash map, concurrent hash map, with anything hash set, so just use that. If this is a normal, apart from that map, so you just use that for each and just use any, you can give it, doesn't matter, you have to use v, k, what, you can use anything x, y, z, and you just use system.out.println, you can find out the result. If I run, now you can see that same result. You don't need to write so many codes. But one twist I want to share you. So that informations, I said, whenever you are actually using that lambda expressions, correct? So that time you are actually instantiate what? Functional interface. Now, in for each method, might be some functional interfaces there. That's what we are applying for the lambda expression. So what is that functional interface? Guess what is that functional interface? That functional interface is actually is nothing but your consumer. Means whatever argument you are actually giving, na. So if you go to that for each method, let's go to for each method. What is their consumer? It's accepting whatever informations we are actually giving. It's accepting, and then inside that they are actually use inside that method what you are actually doing. You are saying, okay, just print this one. You are saying just print this one. Inside that method, actually, you are actually providing the implementations, print this one. Because as I said, consumer, this interface will consume, right? So for each method, it's a taking type is a consumer. So it's a consuming. And then you are actually inside that method, test method. It's nothing but you are actually providing the implementations of the test method. So you are providing the implementations only just print this value. So that's what we are able to see. So this is the twist, and this is how actually lambda expressions work. I think your concept is clear. So let me quickly, if you have any doubt till now, just give me just in the chat box, you just ping if you have any questions till now. If you have any questions till now, so you can ping in the chat box. I'm ready to give the answer till now if you have any doubts. Hello everyone, are you there? Do you have any questions, or shall I pause it for the further? Do you have any questions? Or else I'll post it further. Is it understandable to everyone? Okay. Manas Ranjan Mehra. How functional programming helps in daily project work? As I said, functional programming is the approach, right? So if you remember, I said one statement like whenever new logic will come. So I am giving you the only small example. So while you are working in big project, right? So each and every times, if that new requirement will come, either you have to use that anonymous, you have to create anonymous class, and you have to provide the implementations, right? And first thing is that, and second thing is new requirement will come. So that is means new method, new things you have to write, and then you have to create the object and you have to use that method. So that is means how critical it is. I mean, with in Java, without creating any object, or if it is a static method, you cannot do anything before Java 8, right? So, but you can see just a one line, I mean, how that code has been minimized. Just a one line, you can iterate the whole, your, if it is contained in numbers of data, it's iterate whole the data and it's a printing. So this is the actually main advantage of our daily project. You are asking, right, how it's actually helping. So this is how actually helping in our daily life. So that is means main thing is like your code should be minimized, and you don't need to write too many methods, right? Because I am not writing any methods. I am using that functional interface concept, and I am just annotated it, and based on my requirement, I am writing the logic. So I need to concentrate on the logic. I don't need to concentrate okay, how that method should be, how that I'll create the object, how that anonymous class should be created. So I won't need to bother. I just need to bother about that. Yes. Oh, sorry. So I just need to bother about my logic. So that's what I mean, it's help. So yes, I got your concern. I'll explain that method of reference more details. Give me some time. So let me explain this collections. Okay. And some other thing is there in that PPT. There is external and internal iterators. So whenever we are actually iterating now with the for loop, so those are the external iterator. But why this is an external iterator? Because we need to write in our own way. But when we are using this for each method, so this is basically internal. Okay. So background, JVM will take care. So all those JVM also take care. But thing is, this is more enhanced way because it's a it's a written in JVM side. Okay. So this is how actually I was talking, iterating collections. And second part is before Java 8, how we used to sort any tree map, array list or tree set. Okay. So it's a very painful, right? But they have introduced very decent method. With that method, you can actually sort your map. So one is this method is called comparing by key, another is comparing by value. Okay. So what we are doing? So I have this map. This is the entity set and stream. You will get it later. I mean, I'll tell you about stream later. So just for the time being, we just use this comparing by key. Only these things your map should be sorted by key order. If you run this program, right, this should be sorted. All those things should be key order. First of all, J, then O, then S, then T, then U. So similarly, there is a comparing by value. Okay. So I am not going to discuss it, but yes, you will get this code. Okay. So easily you can understand, but this is a very good method to use this one. And I was talking about this method reference, right? So let's go back to our example. Iterating Java 8. Okay. I said there is a fourth type of method reference, right? So this is a lambda expressions. Just delete this one and delete this one and use this one. Still, it should give the result, same result. This is actually method reference. Because for each method, actually it will take the argument type as a what? Consumer. Can you illustrate a small sample? Yes, definitely. So system.out, what I am saying, just use that println. So this is actually method reference. So you don't need to write, okay, so you don't need to pass that argument type V or X or Y, Z. So automatically it will taken care. So whatever value is there, it will print. So you are talking about method reference on example. So let me show you. Okay. Okay. So I have a class called mechanic underscore T3. Okay. You can see. So there is a one fix method, another is a execute method. Correct? So fix method, what it will do? It will actually get the ID. Okay. And another class is there. I'm showing you. Car C3, T3. So car T3, I have a, so first of all, see, there is a two data member, ID and color. So I am getting it and setting it. So this is my actually Pojo class. Okay. Getting the color, setting the color, getting the ID, setting the ID, and mechanic T3. Okay. So this is my actual class. So I have taken fix, execute, these two methods. In fix method, what I am doing? So I am taking the argument as a car C3 object. Then I am actually fixing the ID, car ID here, you can see. And execute, what I am doing? So in execute, I have a two arguments. One is car object, car T3 object, another is consumer. So consumer, it has a, I say test method is there, right? I accept method, it will accept only. So what I am doing? So I am doing C dot accept actually car. So that is means it will execute, correct? So it's accepting that car object, right? So now I have created my main class object. Also I have created this car class object. Now, in order to these things, I mean fix, I mean I need to use that fix. So I have to provide this object. So how I'll do? Mechanic dot execute, I call this method. Okay, then I provide this car object, then my consumer class, then I actually implementing this accept C3, and then I have provided these things fix, mechanic dot fix. Okay, but what I can do with the method, you can achieve the same things in lambda expressions. This is anonymous class. In lambda expressions, what I am doing, you can see this object dot execute. Okay, so my actual lambda expressions is these things, car C. C is my consumer, it is a functional interface, it has that accept method. So this is my actually lambda expressions, correct? What I am saying, I am saying, boss, this C object, whatever object I am passing here, so you just give it in fix. I mean fix, where is that fix? This method, right? So finally we are actually getting the ID. But method at reference saying, okay, you don't need to do anything. This is a mechanic class, as I said, and this is an object, just object. This is the object method reference dot this method name. Automatically it will take care. So what I am doing? So further I am actually minimizing my lambda expressions and I am providing the meaningful way. So automatically you don't need to write this one, and you don't need to write this one, just give this one. So this is the example. I mean if I show the in some pictures, okay, so you have this one Pojo class, okay, and you have this actually your main class, and there is a inside that main method. Okay, so this Pojo class, there is a getter method and setter method. Okay, and this class, it has a two method. One is fixing the car, actually taking the object, another is execute. So execute, it has a object of car, this class, and also consumer. Okay, so what I am doing, my number one solutions is either we can create anonymous class. What we did here, we have created anonymous class like this way. Second thing is we can do lambda expressions. Okay, so inside, I mean this part we can avoid with that lambda expressions, right? Because this is nothing but a functional interface, and this part we minimize this way. Got it? And then third part, again, we are actually minimizing our lambda expressions. So we are saying, no, this fixed method is belongs to this object, right? So you just annotate this one. Got my point? The point is related to this consumer interface is a functional interface. We are providing the implementations of accept this method. And we are actually using this statement. This final statement is this. So what we are doing, either we can use that lambda expressions with simple things, or we can do just simply this one. From where it get argument as my parameter. What execute method will do? Okay, so this is a good question. So execute method, basically it will execute method. Basically it will setting the object of this car class. You can see the what is actually doing. It's a accepting the object of car class. Okay, so this is the task of that execute method, and then what is actually doing? Hello. Okay, so in execute method, so inside that method we are actually giving this implementations. We are actually fixing this object. So if you run this program, so you will get this fixing car, this ID should be null, I think, because we didn't assign any value. Okay, so let me run. Okay, I cannot run this one. There is some problems in ID. So if you run this one, you will get the this result and this result. Because first of all, see, it is assigning to this fixed method. So fixed method is nothing but you are actually taking the argument and you are going there and you are actually getting the object and you are actually printing this one. And this is indirectly actually implementations of this. So finally, it will call this method actually. So this is actually method of reference. Still, your concept will not clear. So just go through a few examples. I have kept it in my GitHub account. Okay, so already yesterday documents, I have given that link. And still, if you have any doubt, just ping me. I'll try to give the more clarity. Okay, so now this is Java 8 key value, comparing by key, comparing by value. This method they have introduced, and others method get or default. So get or default, I am showing you one example. Okay, how we can, so if somebody will ask for the check the frequency, what you will do? Check the frequency means, so there is a list of data, integer data. You have to find out the occurrence of each of the every number. It's a very important and common questions in the interview, when you will attend the interview. And if you represent with Java 8, they will impress. Okay, so you have a map, you will iterate, and then you will check whether it's a content key. If this is content, then it will you will increase that value by one. If not content, it will put simply key comma one. Then actually you are iterating. But get or default method, what it will do? So get or default method, it will do very interesting way. You don't need that if else statement. Get or default method means you, if you are providing the some key, if that value is present, it will return the value. I mean key is present. If that key is not present, is return the zero. that default value. So right side is default value and left side is key. So this method will take the argument key. If key is present, it will return the frequency of that key. How many times is occurrence? If that key is not present, if you anode 0, this default value, it will return 0. So then I have introduced val plus 1, right? If my key is present, let's say A is present 2 times, so it will return 2, then I am increasing 2 plus 1, that is 3 times. If not present, it is returning 0, then val plus 1, 0 plus 1 means 1 times. So this is very good example. This is a very good example, and you can see that your lots of code has been minimized. So apart from this, there is a put if absent is there. Put if absent means it is doing while you are actually adding some key in that map, what will happen? Suppose you have a key called A and value is 0. I am saying like A value is 0. And now you are trying to add again key A with value 4. What will happen in map? Map, it will allow, it will not give any error, right? It will replace with new value 4. So for this type of, I mean, checking, you can use that put if absent. If absent A, then it will put, means A equals to 0. A key if absent, then it will put A with value 4. If not absent, then A equals to 4, it will not put the map. Got it? So similarly, like there is a several method is there. I mean, remove method is there, replace, replace of, remove if, also the same things. If there is a remove, then if it is a present, it will remove, or else it will not remove. And another thing is compute, compute if absent and compute if present. So this is very important method. So how you can do it? So I am giving you the example. Okay. So this is my map, right? A, B, C with value 1, 2, 3. And I am actually putting A. If you run this code, okay. I am actually putting A. Okay. So what is saying? So this value, I mean, and functions, it's taking the functions, it's key, right? So main purpose is, right, if you are trying to get any keys, okay, I mean, it will, if the value is not present, so it will not throw any null pointer exceptions. Okay. But if that, compute if absent, right? So if that value is present, so it will give that value. If not present, it will not give any null pointer exceptions. It will just add this value. So that is the compute if absent. Means if absent, it will not give any null pointer exceptions. It will add this new key with that value. And there is a compute if present. So it's a slight difference. It will not throw any null pointer exceptions. And also it will not make an entry. The difference is, suppose you are trying to add USA. USA is not there. Let's see, USA is not there. So you are using compute if absent. So if this is present, then it will not do anything. If not present, it will neither not throw any null pointer exceptions, not make any entry. But compute if absent, it will, what it will do, if it is absent, then it will make an entry of this key. And it will also not throw null pointer exceptions. But compute, what it will do, If it is not present, it will throw null pointer exceptions. So that is the main difference. So you just, I have seen like a few of the interviewer ask these questions. What is the use of compute if absent, or put if absent, or compute if present? So this is a very hot topic. You'll face lots of questions related to these sections. And now we'll go to about stream. So one is the common example of stream. Okay. What is the definitions of stream? First of all, stream is a sequence of data with coming a particular source. You can say that source could be a collections, could be arrays, could be any input output channels, anything. So there is a one source. This is there coming in finite sequence of data. So that is basically streams. But one thing you need to remember, stream is not a data structure. Okay. Now one question, is stream is finite or infinite? In the interview, you'll face these questions. Depending on the operations, it could be a finite, it could be infinite. Okay. So stream, what is there in streams? So stream, there is a one source. Okay. Another is intermediate operations, and third is terminal operations. Okay. I'm showing you one example. Okay. So this is intermediate operations and terminal operations. So you can see there is a source, that is a operations, is nothing but intermediate operations and terminal operations. Okay. So I am giving one example. I think most of the persons will aware about that food processing factory, right? So let's say there is a Lay's or Bingo. There is a Bingo company. They are making some chips. Okay. So how that food factory is working? So there could be a source. Source is a potato, right? Raw potato. So there is a raw potato, and there is a one phase is called. So raw potato is a source. Okay. There is a one phase is called washing the potato. Washing the potato. Okay. There is a one phase is called chopping the potato. Basically cutting the potato, chopping. Then one phase is called frying the potato. Okay. It's a frying, basically frying. This process is happening this phase. And this final phase is actually adding salt and some others ingredient, adding, mixturing. And finally, another is packaging. Okay. Finally, there is a packaging. Packaging. Okay. And here you are actually collecting one packet, two packets like that. So you can see this is your source is nothing but a raw potato. This washing potato, chopping potato, frying potato, adding in, adding some masala or salt, anything. So this is one process, and also packaging one process. So this is actually our intermediate operations. And this is our source. And this is our terminal we are actually collecting. This is our terminal. So this, if you remember this picture, I am telling you, your stream concept should be clear. Okay. So I said it's a sequence of data coming from a particular source. If you see, that potato, one by one potato coming from that particular source. It's a sequence of potato. If you see that example, it's a sequence of potato. One potato came, was done, it's sending to the chopping portions. One potato, then again new potato came, washing and sent to the chopping. And then once chopping done, then sent to the fry portions, this one potato. Then this fried one potato came to the adding positions. And then this coming to the packaging. So that is means it's a sequence of a potato, right? So similarly, sequence of data, there is a no stop. So all the process. So one thing is you should remember while attending the interview or working in streams. So any intermediate operations. Okay. So what intermediate operations here, washing, chopping. So always it will return the potato itself. It is not returning anything. It's a potato. So any intermediate operations always return the stream itself. Whatever the operations you are performing, that return type should be stream to the next operations, next intermediate operations. Got it? Because unless until it cannot work. Because these operations can work on stream, right? So any intermediate operations return always stream. Like a potato. So now we understand this fact. Then what is the use of this stream API? Okay. So main thing is point number one. We are actually giving you that some ready-made method. With that method, you don't need to write so many, like you need to search some particular data. You need to add some operations. So for that things, you need to write extra for loop or extra logic. But with the minimum code, with the stream, you can achieve it. There is point number one. Point number two, most important. Stream is not a data structure. It's not storing any data. So what is happening now? So whenever it's getting, it's returning to the next phase again, returning to the next phase again, returning to the next phase. This is happening, right? So this is why, what is happening. So it's not storing the data. It's just processing and sending to the next level. So that is means while you have a large number of data, your data needs to be analyzed. Okay, in collections, what do you will do? So collections, just you have a list of integer data. I'll ask you, okay, find out the data which is, find out the numbers which are prime number. You will perform the operations, then you will save it, store it. So there is a lots of activity, right? But with that stream API, you don't need to store anything. If this is a prime number, you just send to the next level and it will automatically get resolved. So for a huge data, it's very good. And second thing is there is a two type of streams. One is sequential stream, another is parallel. Sequential streams will sequentially, parallel streams will work parallelly. So if your architecture is, I mean, machines is multi-core. So if you use that parallel stream based on your requirement, so that time it's a concept of multi-threading, right? So parallel it will work. So your productivity or your time, your performance should be increased. Okay. So this is the things as I discussed, source. Okay. Intermediate operations, terminal operations, you can see source is nothing but my data. Okay. Intermediate operations, there is a lots of intermediate operations, filter, sorting, converting, mapping. Okay. Peak. Okay. Terminal operations. Yes. There is a aggregated result like count, collecting, sum, those are a terminal operations. It's a very important things in interview. They will ask, they will might be try to, see whether you have a proper knowledge or not in terminal. What are the terminal operations? What are the intermediate operations? Okay. So source, as I said, source, you can create any source with that stream. This method is there, or I mean system.generated. So like this way you can create the stream. I'll show the example, don't worry. Intermediate and terminal operations. Okay, and one thing you need to remember, I said like from pipeline of a stream executions always return streams, I mean any intermediate operations. And one thing, not executed until some terminal operations is invoked. What I am saying, so unless until it will reach to terminal operations, no operation should be performed. So that's what it is called as a lazy initializations. I'll show the example, don't worry. It's a called a lazy initializations. Okay, so stream operations, just try to understand this picture. There is a filter, sorting, map and collecting. Okay, so I have a source of data 1, 2, 3, 5, 6 up to 10. So my first criteria is it should be divided by 3. So inside that predicate, what I did, filter, I just did filter if it divided by 3 or not. If divided, then I got 3, 6, 9 and 6. Then peak means actually I am checking, and then I am adding another filter. If it is less than 6, then you just need to pass it. Then 3, 6, 6 came, 9 got out. Then again I did peak. Peak is nothing but used for debugging purpose. And then finally I am collecting 3, 6, and another 6 should be there. That was missing in the slide. So this is the actual stream. You can see like several operations I perform like a potato chips. First of all, I divide by 3, then I checking debug, and then I checked whether it's less than 7 or not, then allow, then again debug, and then finally collect. So collect is nothing but a terminal operations. Okay, so there is a stream operations. One is intermediate, another is terminal operations, right? But there is a again some dividations. One is stateless, another is stateful. Okay, so what is stateless and what is stateful, right? So you can see map, filter, unsorted, those are stateless. But sorted, distinct, limit, peak, those are stateful. Okay, and there is a terminal operations, sum, mean, max, reduce, average, collect, count, those are terminal operations. Okay, but intermediate operations should be a short circuiting operations. It may produce as an infinite result, right? As I was showing some one example, generate. So if you use that stream dot generate, it will generate random data, and it could be an infinite stream. It's not a finite stream. So you can short these streams with some short circuiting method. So there, yes, there is a called, one is called short circuiting method. So what is the use? To make any infinite stream into a finite stream, we use short circuit mechanism. There is a lots of short circuiting method is there, any match, find fast. Like you are actually doing this operation system.generate. It is generating random number. If you add short circuit, like okay, find that fast result. So then immediately your stream should be stopped because it will try to find. Or if you add that limit, limit also short circuiting. If you add like 5, I mean generate dot limit 5, so it will generate up to 5 data, right? So that is means there is a infinite streams and you just limit it with 5. So that is means you did is the finite stream. Sorry guys. So that is basically nothing but a short circuiting operations. So what is a stateful? Okay, Okay. So you can see map, filter, sorted. So why I am saying it's a stateless. Okay, unsorted. Okay. So if you are seeing, first of all, I am doing filter. So if I am doing filter here, right? So that is means I don't need to, I mean, I am adding only filter. If that number will come and it will divide by 3, then I am passing this number. I don't need to remember what I have got earlier. So that is means I am actually the, I am won't care about it. I am caring like whether it's a satisfied my conditions or not. So that's what is a stateless. It's don't need, it's don't required to remember this earlier data. So that was is a stateless, like map unsorted. But sorted is a stateful. Why? Because if you are doing short, like let's say it's came first 3. Okay, so what you are doing basically, I am trying to explain this one. So if 3 came, so you just try to check with the earlier data. Okay, if earlier came 2, so you need to check with 3 is greater than 2 or not, right? So you need to remember that earlier data, nothing but earlier state. So that's what shorted those are a stateful operations. So that is the definitions of stateful and stateless operations. So stateful means you need to remember that earlier state, like a limit. So if you are doing limit 5, so that is means if you are printing 4 data, so that is means you need to remember, okay, I have did up to 4, so now I am doing 5, so I won't allow the next data. So that is mean distinct, similarly distinct, shorted, skip, those kind of is a stateful. I think you got the definitions. Stateful means like stateful means like you need to remember this earlier states, and stateless you don't need to remember. You can see those intermediate operations are stateful. Now we can able to understand what is short circuiting operations and what is actually stateful and stateless. Okay, so now let me show you some example streams. Okay, short circuiting operations. Limit example. Okay, so limit is a short circuiting operations. Okay, so if you do this example should not be helpful. Reduce example. Peak. Okay, so don't worry, I'm showing you. So let's see, if there is a 3, right? 3 data is there. So if that source is, so basically I'm creating the streams. So this is a one way stream of, so basically it is creating the streams. Okay, so then I have added the limit. So you can see only two, first 2 data, limit and by, this will come and it will finally collect it here. So this 2 will not be there. So that is means I just short circuit with 2. So this is basically short circuit operations. If there is a n numbers of data, so it should be a short circuit with 2. Okay, so now we'll see some example. Okay, stream operations, filtering, sorting, map, I said. So sequential streams means it will run only one code, one iteration, as I said. Parallel streams, it will run on multiple code available on your computer. So one iterations, two iterations, it's running on code 2, code 3, code 5. So what is the difference between parallel stream versus sequential streams? So if you do, if you have a list, okay, so if you have a list, if you have a list and you are actually doing parallel streams, then it will be run as a parallel stream. If you are doing list dot only parallel, so only parallel, why it's taking this? Okay, already I have added this one, list dot. Streams, if you are doing only this, so this is actually basically your sequential streams. So only stream is sequential and parallel stream is parallel streams. Okay, so if you want to achieve the parallel streams, you will use that dot parallel stream method. If you want to achieve sequential streams, so that time you'll use that sequential dot stream. So this is actually sequential streams. Again, my ID hang. Okay, so this is the actually way. Okay, for each, so this is actually sequential streams and this is actually parallel streams. Okay, so we can use, and internally it is using fork join framework. I'll tell you later. Okay, so one questions. As I said, stream is a finite or infinite. I said it's a depend, but we need to remember use of a limit method if you want our program to be finished in a finite time. And another is stream lazy evolutions. What is stream lazy evolution? I said unless until it will execute the terminal operations, it should not be actually executed. So that is why stream is a lazy initialization. So I am showing you these operations. If you see, what is the result? Peak 0 at then 0, peak 2 at 2. Okay. So you can see stream dot iterator. Okay. 0 comma n comma n plus 2. So this n equals to, it's adding 1 by 1. So this is my stream source. Then I am picking this data and then I am finally printing terminal operations. So how it's happening? Like I said, it's a lazy evolution. I mean, one packet chips build, then another packet chips build like this way. Okay. Similarly, you can see it's a peaked at 0, then it's printing this data here. Then again, it's adding here and peak the second data. And then it's checking whether it's permitting that limit or not. And then here it's printing. So like this way, peak at 0, then printing the data, then peak at 2, then printing at the data. So like this way, so unless until it's encountered the terminal operations, for each is a terminal operations. So unless until it is encountered the terminal operations, actual stream operation should not be started. So that's what it is called lazy evolutions. And this is the example. So this is the streams and how many ways we can create the streams. So I didn't tell you, okay, how many ways we can create the streams. Okay. So let me tell you how many ways we can create. So there is a lots of methods. Okay. So creating a streams. Number one is okay. All the example I kept it here, but unfortunately all those are gone. Okay, don't worry. I am showing you. Workshop master. Exercise research in main Java 8 workshop. Sessions to streams. Okay, so this is the creations of streams. So you'll find out this one. Actually, if you have a collections, number one is any collections, I mean list dot or collections dot stream. So this is basically sequential streams, or you can use that stream itself. There is a stream itself. There is a one, I mean class is there. With that class, you can create the streams. Like stream of ABC. So this stream array should be, this should be a your stream. Okay. So this is the of method is there, and also stream builder is there. With that things you can also create. And as I said, stream.generate. So it will basically generate infinite stream with the element. And then I limit it 10. So that is means it's now is finite. So, and also stream.iterate. So stream.generate, stream.iterate, or any collections API dot streams, stream.off. So with those method, we can create any streams. So in order to create any parallel streams, you just use dot parallel streams. So normally it will create the sequential streams. Okay. And one point I want to remember, guys. So like, if you are saying like always to use parallel stream is a beneficial, no. Why? Because if you are running a small programs, so for that things, if you use the parallel stream, there is a no use of parallel streams, right? And second things, if your machine is one core, if you still try to run as a parallel stream, then your performance will be degraded, right? Because your machine is itself one core, and you are trying to write run with a parallel stream, so that is means it doesn't have any other score. So sometimes it's a depend on your machines and depends on the program. So always it's not a mandatory that parallel stream should give always the faster performance. So based on your machines, based on your program and what you are trying to implement, so depend on these things, and it will provide the faster performance. So doesn't mean like it will always give that fast informations. Okay. And so I want to show you one example. Okay. So this example might be helpful to understand the whole scenarios of streams. So why basically we use that streams. Okay. Another point I want to share you. Remember, any stream order should be a very expensive. Why? You need to maintain the stream orders. So I am showing you the example, right? So there is one operations, two operations, three operations. So any intermediate operations, if you not make it properly, then it should be a very expensive. Why? Because if you see the example, if you run the program, what is the output? 1 1. And if you run this program, what is the output? 3 1. Why? Just wait. So I have a list, array list. Okay. So I just create the object, and there is my counter. Okay. What I did, list dot stream dot map, then element, I called is a object was called. Correct? In object was called, that counter is there, right? And then returning substring 0, 3. Then skip 2 and then count. Correct. So then finally I am printing the size. Size it's showing object counter is 3. Size is showing 1 because I have skipped 2. Right. So there is a 1, 2 because 2 is skipped. Only 1 is left in my streams. So that's one is showing the size is 1. And counter, how many times that counter happened? 3 times. Because I skip 2 later. I should skip before that map. I mean immediate this stream. Then it will immediately show this result. If you run this, so this is the operations. I mean how many times iterate? 3 times and 1. And if you put this skip, this is 1 here, right? If you put this one and now try to run, order is 1 because first of all you are actually skipping this 2. So you don't need to calculate this one, you just need this one. So you just fastly skip this one. So that's what order of the stream operations executions is very important. So point number one is stream. So always parallel stream and sequential stream doesn't mean that parallel stream gives the faster performance to the sequential streams. Second point, stream operations executions you have to properly customize. I mean if you do wrongly then it's a very difficult, it's might be expensive this operation. Third thing, stream is any stream intermediate operations always return stream itself. And fourth point, I said about stateful and stateless and what is short circuiting. Fifth point, any stream operations, so there is a call terminal operations. Unless until it will come to the terminal operations, that whole stream should not be evaluated. I shown this example, that's what stream operations, it's a very lazy evolutions. So those are the main point, and any stream could be a finite and infinite depending on the design. Okay, so let's see some example. I want to show you some example. Okay, so let me, I have a array list. Okay, so what I'll do, so I'll try to print if that letter is start with A and I just short this letter. So that is basically my requirement. So normally if you do, you have to write so many codes, right? So if you run this program, you can see the output A1 and A2. Okay, this one. What I'll do, list dot my stream, then filter. Filter, I have used that lambda expressions. Okay, what I did, p dot starts with, what I did if that is a start with A, then you just keep this one. So that is means we got 2, 1. Then again I got map. Map is nothing but a, I am actually converting from one type to another type. So I am converting from a small to uppercase. Then I am shorting. Then finally for each method I am actually printing terminal operations. So this is basically just one line I did whole the code. And you are talking about method reference here. I have used that method reference, you know. So inside that map we can do the same things, like we can use the same things and we can replace with a okay 2 dot upper. You can do same things. If I remove this one now, p dot uppercase 2 uppercase, what is the string? Okay, so if you run this program you will see same result. So that is method of reference. So what I did here, I did 2 uppercase belongs to string class. It's a class level method reference and use this one. And similarly if you are trying to achieve this one, just do same things, right? No, it will not support, because for this case it will not support, because we have to provide that checking with that A. So we cannot do this way. So for that things, that's what I mean, they didn't use that method deference. But any things, any operations you have to annotate without any argument, we can use this is a method deference. Here, this is my checkpoint. So that's what we are unable to do it. Okay. So this is actually method of reference. So I think why that stream is needed, you can got the point. And why this lambda expressions is needed again to minimize our code, and why the method reference is needed. I think you got one, and somebody pinged me. This is when short circuiting. Yes, I explained the short circuiting method in the slide, right? So, okay. Okay, let me explain once again. I was showing stream operations. Right. This example is a perfect example. Before that, I am showing the short circuiting operations. Okay. Okay, where is my example? Let me, okay. Just use for each my terminal operations, right? So what I'll do, I'll system dot out dot println, this method reference I'll use. Okay, println. Okay, so I'll use this one. What is happening? Okay, I got this. Actually, I need to do it here. Okay. So finally done. So let's run the program. You can see 78. I have limit 20. Now, but don't do that. I think my laptop will be hang. Okay. So this is I just stream iterate. It will start from 40 and it will increase by 2. And then I am printing. If you do na, just see, this is an infinite stream. Got it? Just I stopped this one. Okay. And now if you do with the limit functions, you just limiting with 20. So this is actually short circuiting operations. Got it? Okay. So this is short circuiting operations, and I just want to, almost 4:40. I'll quit these sessions within 10 minutes. Just stream operations. You just go through this code example. From there, you will get it, right? So you will get all these. I have created separately. You just remember map is used for actually mapping portions. Short is used for sorting purpose. For is a terminal operations for printing. Filter is for you just adding any criteria. Peak is for actually for debugging purpose. And all match, if it is start with A, then it will give only this result. Any match, it will return all the boolean. Means like if any of the stream will match with that, so it will return true, and if nothing will match, it will return false. And similarly, if all the streams will match with A, then it will return true or else false. So there is so many. If you see the example, I think your concept should be clear. So what I explained, so just remember those points. And let me quickly describe about the multi-threading concurrency concept. Okay, so just I want to finish it with that 10 minutes. So one is threads. So what is thread? You know, I mean, I am not going to describe about that basic level. So we can create the thread with the help of two ways, either extend the thread class or implements the runnable interface, right? So thread is independent tasks. Okay, it can execute separately, it can share the common memory. Okay, so what is the multi-thread pool? Thread pool is nothing but a collections of thread. Okay, and synchronizations means unlocking. This is more details. I'll not get time to describe it, but what they have introduced, so I am just trying to give you the some example. Okay, so number one, so you know the thread concept. So I'll discuss about thread pool. Okay, so what is thread pool or executor service? So you know, I am giving you one restaurant example. So there is a restaurant. In the restaurant, there is only one service person. He is serving the food items. And there is only one cook. And let's say four table is there. So all the tables flop. So if one person is giving order, then that servant is taking the order and giving to the chef, I mean, who is cooking. Then others three tables should be wait unless until he complete the order of this first table, correct? So when he got free, then he will go to table number two. Like this way, table three, table four, it will go. So only one person is giving service. So this is a single thread, and multiple thread, so there is a two servant. Okay, so you can thread pool. If one servant is free, so it is taking the order of others one. So one servant is taking order from table two, another servant is taking order from table one. So then that time table three and four is waiting. So once they have finished, then they are picking the order from table three and table four. So this is it's a call as a thread executor service or thread pool, or you can say it's a multi threading concept. Multiple thread, service person is working simultaneously. So that's what I mean, that servicing, I mean, you don't need to wait so many times in that restaurant. And also multiple cooker is there. You don't need to order, wait. Just you have given the order, they have taken the order, it has assigned to particular cooker and it is servicing to you. So this is the concept of multi-threading or thread pool. So there was a fourth thread pool concept. One is executor service, executor classes is there, and executor service is there. So I am going to discuss about few things. First of all, executor, this is an interface. Okay, this interface actually implements by another executor service interface. Then there is an abstract executor service. This is actually class, and this is a schedule executor service. So this is how actually representations. So how many ways we can create the thread pool? So number one is a single thread pool. If you want to create only one thread with the pool, so that time you will use that single thread pool. So another is one is fixed thread pool. Fixed thread pool, if you assign five, so that means with that five thread, it will create that pool. So pool is nothing but as I am saying, five worker is working there. So you are assigning the tasks to the worker. That worker is simultaneously working. Okay. So once that is finished, then again, they are picking the next tasks. Okay. So this is the concept, like a servant, as I said, in restaurant. So once their order has been finished, they are going to the another table. So it will start with a fixed. And then another is called is a cache thread pool. So what it will happen? So based on your criteria, suppose if there is a two person, like there is a 8 table is there, two person came for the order, I mean for restaurant. So then two, let's say two servant that manager assign, okay, take the order. Okay, and again immediately another person came to the restaurant and occupied the table 3. Then what it will do, manager just seeing, okay, that person is waiting, okay, let me assign another serviceman, nothing but a 3, to that table. So this is a cache. I mean, based on your tax, I mean, overload will increase, then automatically JVM will create another thread. And you can see, I said about one manager. One manager is looking care, okay, so this is waiting, so this is waiting. This manager is nothing but a thread pool executor service. So that is actually controlling all the thread. So that manager is actually controlling all the service person. Okay, you go there, you go there. Okay, this table is full up. So similarly actually doing in happen in the real life in our program. Got it. So they have introduced one thing. This is called, as I said, single thread pool executor. It will create only one thread pool and manager would be there fixed. If you give 5, so 5 thread will be created, cached. So based on your, I mean, if there is a workload will increase, so it will automatically create new thread. And if that workload will be decreased, it will automatically destroy that thread. Okay. And schedule, based on your schedule time, it will create the thread. Okay. So this is the new additions of work stealing thread pool. So that's what I am saying, like what is the new additions in executor service. Work stealing thread pool. With that name you can understand. But if somebody is saying frog join is not a replacement of the thread executor service. It's a different way you can achieve the multi-threading concept that frog join has been introduced in 7. But there is a pretty much similarity between frog join and this work stealing thread pool. So let's see the example. So work stealing thread pool. So normally what will happen? If any work will come, so it will submit to that queue. Okay. So thread A and thread B, it is taking from that queue and it's a working. Okay. If thread B, that task has been completely done, you can see it's queue, there is a no task and there is a no task, then immediately thread B, what it will do, it will steal the work. That is means indirectly stealing. It is take the work from the thread A pool, okay, queue, and it will try to execute. So that is means, so if there is a multiple thread is working, if one thread is is seeing like a, I don't have any work, okay, so take one work from this thread and I just execute it. So similar things like what will happen now. So if you same things in restaurant, so 3 servicemen is working, so 2 servicemen is occupied with 2 tables and 1 serviceman is still keep quiet because no other person is there. So he is seeing like there is a multiple orders. Okay, so one is a curd rice, one is a you can say fried rice, chicken. So that service 3 man person, what he is doing, he is taking few orders on the behalf of serviceman 2 and it's giving to that table number 2. So that is mean indirectly that person is doing some job on behalf of 2, because that serviceman 2 also doing, but serviceman 3 doesn't have any work. So that is mean he is stealing the work. So that is the concept of stealing algorithm they have been introduced in that things. And this is a pretty much similar to frog join. And internally this parallel stream, as I said, internally follow this frog join algorithm. Okay, so this is about to related to executors, I mean multi-threading concept. So because of this time constraint, I am unable to explain that JVM more advanced concept, I mean what they have introduced like Metaspace. Already it's now 4:50 and I'm so much tired. Okay, so what you will do guys, so you just go through my that particular GitHub link, okay, and download all the code and just try to go through that code. If you have any issues with that code, just let me know. Okay, so let me showing you once again. Just admin debu, type admin debu, okay, in GitHub, and there is a Java 8 complete guide. You will find it out. Okay, so in the sections there is a two things. One is example, as I said, session wise I have segregated. Another is tryouts, so you can practice yourself, right? So if you have any doubts, just ping me.